Hey, what's up? This is Kyle Sanders from the band Hell Yeah, and you're watching Good Company.
Good Company!
Hey guys, my name is Scott Bowling, and you're watching Good Company. Today we have the man, Kyle Sanders.
Yeah, man.
Kyle Sanders is the bass player for Hell Yeah. They've done a couple albums with Kyle. And also, Kyle played in Blood Simple, which, man, I loved back in the day. And he was in Peace Dogs.
Oh.
With John Conley. You guys got to bring that back, by the way.
Taking it back to 1990.
Yes, definitely. Thank you, man.
Yeah, brother. Of course, brother.
So how you been?
I'm good, man. I'm busy. It's good to sit down here for a minute.
But I know.
We're going.
Nice. Yeah.
It's good. It's a good thing.
So you guys just did, you were involved with the Dime Bash recently.
Just did it last weekend, yeah.
Was this your first time doing
Dime
Bash?
It was the first time doing Dime Bash, yep.
That's great. So what do? They give you like a couple songs to learn, you know?
Yeah. I did We did something at Aftershock last fall, you know, last year. And we did it here as the first time we really did a, it was a lot of us involved, but I was kind of, me and Jose from Sirius, kind of, he curated the whole thing. And I was working with him on that, getting a, you know, revolving door of musicians coming through, playing just a whole tribute for Vinny, which was just huge for me and fans alike, everybody involved. And it was really a first time that I played since everything happened. And then Dime Bash, they do during the NAMM convention, the big craziness in Anaheim. So yeah, Rita, who Dime's ex, called and wanted me to be involved in that because I'd never done it before. So yeah, it all just came together. It was a full night of people paying tribute to the Abbotts. It was pretty special.
When you got to jam with Vinny, what was that like? I mean, Hell Yeah already had released a few albums by that point.
Hell Yeah had a few, and I was in my band Blood Simple. Toured with Hell Yeah. We toured the first Hell Yeah tour when Vinny first got back on stage. So I thought that was just monumental for me, you know, for being there. And then we did several tours with them. Chad helped us, got us our record deal. So we bonded with all those guys and built good relationships. So I kind of, came up with them playing together, And then a couple bands after Blood Simple, Hell Yeah took us out, So I was really in good with the bands. So when things came together where they were looking for a bass player, it was more of a phone call saying, now's the time. Do you want to do it? So it all just came together, and we started playing together. But playing with him was just, as far as playing, it's like sitting here with you, total cool, laid back as a brother. But then when you go home and you step outside the box for a minute, you're like, damn, I'm playing with Vinnie Paul, and people come up and be like, what's it like playing with him? It's like, man, it's just playing with like the best drummer in the world. That's all.
Yeah, definitely.
It's awesome, man.
Kind of going back, I mentioned this earlier, you were in Peace Dogs with John Conley.
We started playing music together. We went to, I think, 1 year, 2 years of middle school, and then through high school together. So we just, and we're both huge music fans, and it was always, Kiss and Iron Maiden and Rush and all this stuff. So we used to just air guitar in bedrooms. I mean, we should just start playing, make a band, figure that all out. So I was like, well, what do you want to play? He's like, I want to play drums. Like, well, all right, I thought I was going to play guitar. So he's like, all right, guitar, drums, let's go. Bought some gear, set it up in his basement. And then I started playing. I immediately started playing with my fingers, just naturally. I was like, well, obviously, I'm a bass player. So I tossed the guitar, got a bass. And then, we started playing together and just played with different people doing covers. And then I joined the band.
Amazing to play drums, though,
It's great. Yeah, he's a drummer. He's an awesome drummer. Don't let anybody tell you differently. He's amazing.
But back then, he never said, let me try the guitar.
Doesn't talk about it. He's a great drummer, man. And he started playing guitar during Peace Dog rehearsals. I'm like, man, why are you playing guitar? You're a drummer. You're awesome. Just focus on that. It just was weird to watch him play guitar because I knew he was going to get better and better and better. He can play piano and xylophone and, he's
xylophone.
One of those dudes, he can do everything. And now he's a great guitar player in Seven Dust, amazing band. Morgan's phenomenal drummer as well. But it's like, and Morgan knows how good of a drummer John
is. Yeah, so he's telling me. I was like, where's the proof? I mean, where is
the footage? Exactly, get behind the kit,
There's got to be some kind of VHS.
I'll guarantee you, I got some beta for you if you want me to bust it.
Yeah, we'll put in the intro. So you guys did Peace Dogs. Did you tour or anything?
We did a little bit of touring. We did a lot of Atlanta stuff. And then we were a band for a long time and then got a deal in 91. It was band, label Energy Records. And we came out and did a tour with Propane, which was awesome. The old Crumb Sucker dudes. That was huge. We did like Northeast tours, runs with them. So we did a minimal touring with Peace Dogs. And then that kind of fell apart and we all went our separate ways. And then I just started, it's like, well, this is just the beginning for me. So I kept looking for bands and looking, and started touring more and more and more and more.
A different stuff.
Still the stuff, yeah.
And so you had Blood Simple, which we got right here. This is your first Blood Simple album on vinyl, whether you knew it was on vinyl
or not. Yeah, I'm not real sure about that one. I had to look into that, see if I got any 5 cents for
Everything's
that
on vinyl now. But this, I used to be a big Tim. He was
VOD.
In VOD, yes.
Vision Disorder, yeah.
Vision Disorder. Tim, I used to Mike, love them back in the day.
Yeah, Tim's voice was just, that's what sold me on hooking up with them.
How did you hook up with Tim?
It was through the original drummer, Chris Hamilton, who's playing on that record. He was playing with Tim and Mike. And they're like, we're putting this band together. It's really cool. We're looking for a bass player. Mm-hmm. And so I just went up, and it was just an instant click. Those guys are brothers. They're total, way cool guys, and just started recording stuff. And then we got a deal fairly quickly from Chad Gray seeing us play one time. He's like, I want you guys to come up and play, do a Mudvayne show. So just went up and did one, open up for them one time. He's like, all right, I got to start a label because I want to sign you guys.
Oh,
so we started a label called Bully Goat, got assigned to it, and then took the label and got it to Warner Brothers. So they released a reprise, Warner. So they put that out, and then a second record after that out.
That's really cool that Chad's trying to help you guys out.
He's been helping since back then, yeah. And then I was in a band after this called Monstro, which was an Atlanta band.
Monstro.
Okay. Yep, which is cool. Like, it was more like a psychedelic rock, heavy, like Soundgarden, Jane's Addiction-ish, but then just a little trippier kind of stuff. And Chad took us out on Hell Yeah tour. So I toured Blood Simple with Mudvayne, Blood Simple with Hell Yeah, Monstro with Hell Yeah, so it's just all led up to me joining the band 5 years ago.
And also, kind of going back, your brother plays bass too, but
he does too.
Did you play before him when you and John were kind of messing around?
Yep, and he would just listen in the room next door. I was like, yeah, that sounds good.
Is he older?
He's in the middle. I got three brothers.
Oh, okay.
Darren Bubbers is the youngest, and he texts for everybody. He's probably a bigger rock star than us. He's constantly working. He's out with the Mastodon now. He's doing Kerry King for the rest of his run, for the rest of the year. So he's killing it. And then Troy's in the middle, and then I'm the oldest.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah, man.
So you guys did this album, and man, I love these songs, like What If I Lost It. Was that your single, I think?
It was the single.
Yeah, it was a great song, man. Yeah, it's a great album. I love this album.
Yeah, I love that one too, man.
I kind of revisited when you were coming on the show here.
That's probably where I did the most touring. Like, we started touring hitting it hard. Like, we were just bought an RV and toured constantly.
Yeah.
Constantly. So that's where really get my touring legs. Was done tours before that. I was in a band called Screw out of Austin. It was like an industrial metal band, and we did some touring. And that's where I really started touring a lot worldwide.
Do you enjoy it back then, touring?
Oh, yeah. I enjoy it just as much then and now. It's just a different headspace and different lifestyle, But I still completely love it. Like, do it till I die.
How long did it take you guys to do your second album? Is it Red Harvest?
No. Red Harvest, that first record, we toured a good cycle, year and a half, and then took a little bit of time off and went straight in to do that record. And I think we did a Hell Yeah tour on that. We did Family Values tour, which was with Korn.
Oh, yeah.
And Hell Yeah was on that.
Was that the first time you met the guys in Hell Yeah?
The first time was back in this day.
Oh, I'm sorry.
This was the first record, so that's when I first met them. So by the time this came around, it was just like clock, it was just meant to be. It was just a fit.
Cool. So you guys did two albums, and you guess you went your own way? Or
did two records, and then, like everything else seems to happen. I'm in it till the end, and then it just, one person, just things happen with people mess their own lives up and have to take some time off, and then 1 month turns into two, turns into six, and you can realize, well, I got to keep moving, because I don't know if this is going to happen again, which it didn't.
So that was in the early 2000s, or was it mid-2000s?
I think this was two or three, and then Red Harvest was 05, I think. So it went to about... And then Family Values, I think, was 06. Yeah.
What was
06 or 07, so it was a good...
What was your band right after this? You said it was Monstro.
Right after that was the band Monstro.
Monstro,
yeah. Which is a four-piece, and that was an Atlanta band, all based out of here.
Can people find that online?
We signed a deal with Vagrant Records on that, and we put one record out. I love it, too, man. It's different than Hell Yeah, different than Blood Simple, different than everything else I've done. Still heavy, but its vocals are real melodic. It's kind of... Kind of psychedelic, but
you ever think you'll like revisit that anytime in the future?
We never really broke up. Bevin, the drummer, who's amazing, he played with me in Blood Simple. He's played in Danzig. He's doing Zoso now, the Zeppelin tribute, which if anyone hasn't seen that, it's amazing. And then he started doing that. I was doing Hell Yeah. So we never really broke up. We just said, well, we're busy. We're doing other things. So we would love to do something again if we could all get back together and find the time to do it. It's just a matter of making it happen.
Oh, nice.
Cool.
So from there, you did you take a break from that with Hell Yeah?
Or did no, Chad... once I started Hell Yeah, it's been Hell Yeah since 2013. So there's no, I mean, the small breaks that I've had up until now was no time to do a side project or to do something else.
You know? Really?
So, yeah.
Just full on.
Full on. Full on.
Who made that connection, you said, when you were joining Hell Yeah? Was that Chad? Or
that was, originally it was Chris Hamilton, who he played in a band, Downset. He's played in a lot of different
Downset.
Bands. Yep.
Yeah,
and then he hooked up with Tim and Mike with Blood Simple, so he called me, and then I came up, and I think that's when I first really met Chad. That's what started all that. Yeah,
It's huge. And so you guys did your first one, Blood for Blood, with Hell Yeah?
My first one, yeah. They had three prior to that, so this is the fourth one that I came in on, and then we did Undeniable, which was the one we were finished touring on, and then we can talk about whatever, you know, the record that we just finished.
Yeah.
It was the third record, yeah.
Speaking of, when is it, is that is coming out though, right?
Crazy, absolutely coming out. It had, when Vinny passed, all his tracks were done, you know, we were in the studio when all that happened, so it was just completely just...
But they do the drums first, right? So all we did his tracks were...
We kind of do it that way, yeah, we did the drums... It was all the instruments kind of were laid down, but most of them were scratch tracks, and the drums were like perfected. So then we move on, and then sometimes we do guitar for next, and then bass. We kind of did it song by song, like not the whole record. Like once Vinny was done, then we all did one song, guitar, bass, and move on to the next song, guitar, bass, and then vocals at the very end, so they're last. So yes, it's coming out, and we're talking about it right now because we took a few months off just dealing with all this.
Yeah,
and
it's tragic.
Yeah, it's just brutal. And it will come out this year. I can 100% guarantee it. And we're gonna decide how we're gonna promote it. And you know, it's not like we're just gonna release it and let it go and then just let it fade away. We have to do something with it. It's just a matter of tastefully and respectfully. And you know, Vinny would be pissed if we didn't. You know, like all he cared about was this band.
Really?
He didn't. Once he's done with something, he's done with it. You know, like Pantera came up all the time and Damage Plan, but. Once he moved on, that was it. You know, he focused on what he's doing now. So Hell Yeah is all he cared about. So to let this record not see the light of day and not get it out to people and perform it live, however we're going to do that, you know, it would be disappointing him. He would never want that to happen. So it's going to come out, and we're going to do some kind of touring on it, whether it's a full cycle, I don't know, or we're going to start small and short and sweet and just kind of build ourselves up to it and see how
that's
it goes.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Man, that's so good you're doing that.
Yeah, we have to.
You guys were in a band. You were in a band with Vinny for how many years now? Was it like...
It was like Christmas of 2013, and we were doing, you know, happened June of last year, so, you know.
And did Hell Yeah, did you record in the same place, Damage Plan and all that?
They did the first record at Dimes,
at
Dimes House.
Okay.
And after that, we did a lot of it. Vinny had a small studio in his house, and we did a lot of demo stuff. I think all the demo stuff. And then we took it to the last three records have been with Kevin Churko in Vegas. Mm. Proper, nice, beautiful studio with, you know, all the gear and decked out.
When you guys record in Vegas, do you stay there?
Or Vinny had a house in Vegas.
Oh, yeah.
So just happened to work out. So in Dallas, we all stay. When we start the tour, because they got bungalows in the back and, you know, private rooms for everybody, so we'd stay there. And when we were touring or before touring.
So what's the secret of, like, hanging out with Vinny and doing, you know, partying with him and doing a show? Do you pace yourself? Like, how's it?
Yeah, and he does too, you know.
Like, I know.
He just enjoys life, you know.
He
will go out 7 days a week because he has to. You know, he would never just sit at home. Like, I go to his house, it's all chill and vibed out. I was like, man, this is awesome. He's like, man, I'm bored to tears. I'm like, oh, damn. He's like, I'm going out to see whatever. If it was just a cover band playing, he'd find it and he'd go see it.
Yeah.
But he wasn't out drinking and partying every night.
Yeah.
He definitely absolutely would, and we would together. But there was a lot of nights he would just go out because he just loved entertainment and loved live music and talking to people and just would go out. Like, he's just very outgoing, and you know. But he wasn't like hitting it hard every night, just going 24/7. You know, get older, you can't do that.
Yeah, going on tour, you can't do that every
night. And going on tour, you definitely pace yourself. You know, going into a day off, it's like a relief. So you might blow off a little steam, but other than that, you know, it's a job. And if you don't perform and deliver, then people are going to stop checking you out. You know, if you're just going through the motions. So
since we're talking about Vinny, is there any like special story you want to share, like you and Vinny like hanging out or any kind of? Like, everybody says, what's your dime story? But what's your, like,
right.
Do you have a Vinny story?
And the thing is, everybody has one, you know, some crazier than others. I just think it was the most special part to me was, you know, he was just a little bit older than me, and we're still doing it for the same reason. So to be with someone, everyone in the band, for that matter, you know, everyone's had their, you know, levels of success, you know, some more and some less than others, but everyone is in it for one reason. It's because you love music and you love being with each other, you know? Like, so many bands have their own buses, which I never really got, but now I kind of do get, you know. But I just thought, you know, I grew up playing like in Peace Dogs and with John, we lived together, warehouse, like that's just what you do.
Yeah.
Eat, drink, party, sleep, play, everything you do is together. So that's the way that I just, you know, thought and think it should be. And I think just the fact with being with him, like it got to the point in Hell Yeah where me and him were on the phone, not booking the tours, but like strategizing, like with a booking agent, where we wanted to play and what we wanted to do and going through the budgets, like taking a big role and helping him out with the business end of it. Mm-hmm. And picking out the spots on the tour, like where we know is a good place to barbecue. That was like about the same level as the actual venue itself compared to how we were going to throw down that night, because I've got a day off. It's the killer parking lot. I know we got the catering right there. So it was just those kind of nights, you know.
That's great.
Those moments to build up to those. And then it's a barbecue where everyone's invited. He would feed the entire tour.
Yeah, great with all the opening bands.
He wouldn't take a dime. We'd all want to put in our per diems or our buyouts for, you know, to go to Sam's or whatever and do to load up. And he wouldn't take a dime. He's like, I'm buying it all. He just helped me out with the prepping and the cooking. It was like, boom, you're there. So everyone had their jobs to do. And that just helps the morale of the whole tour, you know, because it can be a grind sometimes and mm-hmm. kind of depressing sometimes, or just the monotony, or things aren't good at home or aren't good on the road. Just things like that brings everybody together and picks everybody up so you can go do it another day or week or month or whatever. Mm.
That's really great.
Yeah, man.
So now what you're doing is Let There Be Rock. I'm reading your shirt. You're representing.
Yeah, man.
So what's that all about?
It's another thing I've been talking about for the past probably a good couple years, maybe longer, but I've just been so busy touring. When I'm home for a week or maybe a month, can't focus on starting a new business or project or something, so it never was really the time. Mm-hmm. And then now after Vinny, I was just sitting home, none of us are doing well. Everyone was dealing with it in their own ways. Yeah. So I was like, I gotta have something to focus on that's positive and productive and something that I can give back and it makes me feel good and I can mm-hmm. do things for other people, make other people feel good. So it's basically a performance-based rock and roll community center. It's like, and I say kids, but it's all ages from as soon as you can pick something up and play, you know, five-ish till all the way to like an adult program.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's cool.
Completely. So it's like a one-on-one lesson and then getting in there, start forming bands with people that can kind of mesh together with the same kind of chemistry and talent level. Forming bands, working towards playing shows.
Yeah.
Every 12 weeks of trying to do it and just keep it going. And it's going to be open to, if you're in the school, then the facility is yours, you know, to hang out. If there's an empty room with some gear to go jam on, just go for it, you know. If you want just somewhere to hang out, that's just.
How'd you get that idea? I mean, like, where did it come from?
My friend Scott Marcerone, who opened one up in, let's say Baltimore, but it's Frederick, right outside of Baltimore. Yeah. And he did it 9 years ago. And that's who I was first, you know, was talking with about it. And we played a place called Shiley Acres, which a lot of bands that you've had have played up. This is killer. Mr. Shiley's got a farm in, Inwood, West Virginia. Brings bands up, does it right, treats them right. And he would bring his Let There Be Rock kids, Scott, would bring them out to open up every show. And they'd be playing in front of thousands of people. And it would start at like 1 o'clock and they'd play like three songs each. And they just line up, you know, single file. One band would go up, go rock it, and the next band would go. And I thought cool. That was always so cool. And people love seeing younger kids playing, especially when they're good, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like nowadays, go on YouTube and it's like, why are these kids so good?
Yeah.
If I'd seen that when I was younger, I would have never picked it up.
Yeah.
I'm never going to be as good as this 7-year-old
totally
girl playing John Bonham.
It still
blows me away. But seeing that and seeing how cool it was and seeing just the smiles on people's faces in the crowd and the kids, I didn't have anything like that. You know, we're just in the garage until we could finally figure out how to write our own song and then book our own show. So it's been like a long time coming in my head. And now with the time that I've had and I do have, it's just the time is right. Mm-hmm. So we've bought a building here in Gainesville, Georgia, and I'm actually about to close on it, and we're going to open it up probably end of February and just get going, man, and open it up. And
that's amazing.
Yeah, it's cool.
I really, really like that.
It's really cool. And I'll have, like, you know, all my friends that are into it, they want to come and just be a guest instructor or guest hangout for the day. Like, that's all, like, part of the school. It's not like I'm going to start doing meet and greets and charging. Like, if you're in the school, then you get it all, you know.
Oh, that's cool.
So yeah, I'm really excited and looking forward to it.
What do you think about like joining a different band, or if that, you know, if somebody comes calling tomorrow? I mean, this.
Well, there have been some calls, and I've never, all the way from when I started till like yesterday, I've always been, for better or worse, all my eggs in one basket. You know, I don't know if I would necessarily say that's the way to do it. That's the way that it works for me. Like, I need to focus on one thing.
So this is your...
No matter what it is, if it's, you know, relationship, wife, music, whatever it is, if I say I'm going to do something, that's what I'm going to do. So that's what I've never even considered doing something on the side. Now I'm cool with it, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not like I'm, hell yeah, it's quitting, you know. I'm not doing anything like that, but it is cool to play with some other people and to record some songs, whether anything happens with it or not. It's kind of like a breath of fresh air. And I'm absolutely going to play around. Like, I'm never going to stop playing, you mm-hmm. know.
That's important what you just said, that hell yeah is not quitting, you know.
Right. I mean,
that's pretty bold.
And that's a huge, huge question out there. Yeah, like, what are you guys going to do? And we're like, we're figuring it out. We're going to do something. And other people just assume that it's over.
Yeah.
Like, I've been out and someone introduced me and someone's like, yeah, he used a former member of Hell Yeah. I'm like, you just assume that, you know, like, oh, it must be over because Vinny's gone, which is, it can easily end. Like, mm-hmm. it can easily end right now. We can just say we can't do it anymore. But knowing what Vinny would want and knowing all the work that he's put into it and we've put into it, it's not over, you know, it's just different.
Yeah.
And the way we go about business now is going to be different. We can't just jump on a bus and go tour for 8 weeks at a time and think everything's going to be great, because it's not, you know. And once we got to get a few shows under our belts and then see how, you know, everybody's head is, and we'll take it one day at a time.
Wow. That's really cool.
Crazy, man.
Let There Be Rock. Is there a website people can look at?
There is. Let There Be Rock, GA.com. Yep. So Facebook is all over it, and Instagram all over it, and website. And it's just gearing up right now, and talked to a bunch of people this past weekend at this NAMM show and the Dime Bash. Everyone is just so supportive and thinks it's the, you know, just, it, I know I'm doing the right thing. It feels right. Everyone is really into it with me, and it's like the best thing I think I could do with my life.
I think it's
right
a great
now.
Idea. I love it.
Yeah, it's cool. And I got kids that are going to be in it, you know, and then their friends are going to be in it. And then I got their parents are like, oh man, I used to play guitar. I was like, well, now's the time, man. You know, it's never too late, you know?
That's cool. Well, Kyle, man, I appreciate you being on the show.
Dude,
this
it,
is really good.
I love it so much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, brother.
I
appreciate it.